After the breakout of attacks in the Red Sea in late 2023, the American aircraft carrier USS Eisenhower, nicknamed Ike, was sent to help protect commercial shipping routes. According to the US Navy, it was a historic and unprecedented combat deployment, which included a long list of firsts achieved while engaging Houthis' drone and anti-ship ballistic missiles. In total, the Eisenhower Strike Group launched 155 Standard missiles, 135 Tomahawk missiles, 60 air-to-air missiles, and released 420 air-to-surface weapons. Moreover, Ike's pilots logged over 31,000 flight hours, while they completed over 10,000 sorties. Typically, a carrier deployment lasts around 6 months. But with all the action happening in the Middle East, the US Navy extended Eisenhower's deployment twice. And 9 months later, Ike desperately needed a replacement. But there was a problem. There were no supercarriers available to replace it. You see, the US Navy has 5 aircraft carriers stationed at the East Coast, which typically patrol the Atlantic and the Middle East, and 6 carriers on the West Coast that patrol the Indo-Pacific. The problem was that when the time came for the Eisenhower to be relieved, all the carriers in the East Coast fleet were down for maintenance. As a result, USS Theodore Roosevelt, which was stationed on the West Coast, was chosen to relieve it. But to do so, it had to ditch its original mission of patrolling the Indo-Pacific region, leaving a defensive gap in its wake. But why the US government is allowing foreign companies to purchase American shipyards? How, despite having more aircraft carriers than the rest of the world combined, the United States is experiencing a carrier shortage, and why even having more ships won't resolve the current carrier shortage issue is not what you think. This is USS Gerald R. Ford, the newest and most technologically advanced carrier ever built by any nation in history, and right now it's completely unusable. In response to the outbreak of war in Israel, the Gerald R. Ford, while on its maiden voyage, was extended twice, and finally returned to the US in January 2024, after 8 months at sea. Despite being the Navy's deadliest carrier, it's stuck in port, and won't be able to set sail until 2025 at the earliest. The reason being that the ship is undergoing maintenance availability, which lasts about a year, during which repairs are made to the ship which cannot be done while at sea. As part of this process, USS Ford is receiving software upgrades, undergoing magnetic calibration in order to reduce vulnerability to sea mines, and receiving other touch-ups prior to her next deployment. Some argue that the main reason the Navy is running short on ships from both the East and West Coasts boils down to not being able to fix the carriers on time. But other factors such as high costs, staff shortages, strained supply chains, and lengthy construction times of new ships also play a huge role. Aircraft carriers are big, like really big, and that means that there are millions and millions of parts on each. From the screws holding up a sailor's tiny bunk bed to nuclear reactors generating power for the entire ship. And all of these require some level of maintenance. When these ships return from overseas voyages, they need anywhere from a few months to an entire year's worth of repairs. And even then, they still don't manage to get everything. During those repairs, the ship cannot be deployed. So it has to sit in whatever bay it was parked at while different crews work to get it back into operational shape again. But this is actually causing some issues, as both the spare parts and the crews to install them have been short for several years now. This has led to what some are calling a carrier shortage. But there are 11 full-size aircraft carriers in the United States Navy, which is more than the rest of the world combined. So how exactly is there a shortage? It's time to learn about the rule of thirds. This rule states that one-third of the military forces should always be available for combat, while one-third of the force is preparing for combat, while the final one-third is recuperating after participating in combat. So in case of the supercarriers, according to the rule of thirds, at any given time, one-third of the carrier fleet is deployed, another third is preparing for or coming off a deployment, and the last third is undergoing maintenance. Since the US Navy has 11 flat tops, according to the rule of thirds, you'd expect 3 to 4 carriers to be deployed at any given time. But since currently there are only 2 carriers deployed, USS Theodore Roosevelt and USS Abraham Lincoln, it implies a shortage of deployed carriers. I should note that in case of emergency, it is possible for the US Navy to surge 6 or even 7 flat tops to be deployed at the same time. But it won't happen overnight, as it may take up to 90 days to surge. Surging also means that the standard deck certification cycle would have to be bypassed, and pilots would have to be certified on the go, while steaming to the combat area. Now, you may ask, wouldn't it be possible to repair all 11 carriers and surge all of them at the same time? The answer to it would be no, because of refueling. While the nuclear-powered American supercarriers have unlimited range, the fuel inside of the reactors only lasts up to 25 years. Once the fuel is consumed, the reactors need to be refueled. This is known as ARCO, or Refueling Complex Overhaul. This is only done once, at the midpoint of a carrier's lifespan, and is the most intense maintenance period any nuclear-powered ship can go through. To prepare for this kind of service, a massive hole is cut into the hull of the ship to allow for easier access to the inside. And everything from the catapult system to water purifiers, air conditioning systems, and even toilets are pulled out and replaced with more modern versions. Even though in the past decades these overhauls took up to 4 years, the Navy is experiencing significant delays with these. After arriving at the Newport News Shipbuilding Yard to start their ARCO processes, both USS George Washington and USS John C. Stennis were found to have significant damage to their generators, like the one you're seeing right now, that seemed to catch everyone by surprise. These generators take the steam produced by the onboard nuclear power plant and convert it into both mechanical energy and electricity, making them absolutely critical for carrier operations. During the pre-process inspection, the damage was discovered, but the crews were only prepared to perform maintenance on them, not to rebuild them entirely. This led to the USS Washington's ARCO process to take an extra 2 years on top of the already 4-year-long job. Had the delays not been present, it would have been Washington that would have replaced the Roosevelt, but when the time came, it still had several months left of repairs. USS Stennis is facing similar delays, with the damage tacking on additional repairs, meaning that it would take 5.5 years to repair the carrier instead of 4 years. The delays forced the Navy to scramble ships and crews around, with USS Washington sent from South America to the Pacific in order to conduct a hull exchange with USS Ronald Reagan. Hull exchanges are when the crews of the same kind of ship are swapped out, and it allows for a carrier to quickly redeploy, while giving sailors a much-needed break. Hopefully the Washington's crew remembered to give the new guys the Wi-Fi password before they left. But if carriers are so important to American strategy, why not send more workers to help fix them? In World War II, United States Navy sailed over 100 different carriers at once. Well, unfortunately, it's not that simple. In the United States, there are only 4 national shipyards that can do these kind of repairs, down from 19 about 50 years ago. Working in these facilities requires a high level of skill and training, and the Navy is struggling to replace the older, more experienced crew members as they retire. The new workers they manage to hire lack the experience and generally just work less efficiently. Recently, foreign companies like the Korean Military Naval Company, Hanwha, have purchased former military shipyards in the United States. While it may seem counterintuitive, this is actually being praised by the US Navy, as they're hoping the added international competition will drive domestic companies to improve repair times, or else lose out on the lucrative multi-million dollar contracts. During the 2020 COVID pandemic, productivity at Navy repair facilities dropped to historic lows, and the builders of new ship components suffered an equal level of setbacks. When you measure carrier repair in years, rather than days or weeks, any kind of delays can cause surprisingly long-lasting issues that are still being felt 4 years later. Depending on which aircraft carrier is being worked on, anywhere between 5 and 15,000 people are required for the job. That's a lot of screws that need tightening. Some of the work is performed by thousands of sailors that call these aircraft carriers home while at sea. But the Navy has struggled to meet recent recruiting goals, and ships like USS Ford have reduced their crew numbers by 500, which means maintenance periods will take even longer. Sailors famously dread working in these shipyards, though, calling some of the docking ports where carriers are maintained as Satan's Pier. Balancing the deployment numbers of aircraft carriers with those in port is no simple task, and it's up to the President and the Secretary of Defense together to decide if sending one is worth the risk and cost. These deployments typically last anywhere between 6 to 9 months, but with a nuclear-powered aircraft carrier, they can theoretically go for decades, as long as the ship receives a steady influx of supplies. Just don't expect the sailors on board to be thrilled if you tell them their trip got extended 20 years. But let's say the United States needed more carriers at sea and cost wasn't an issue. Why not just do less maintenance on the ship and not worry too much if one of the coffee makers is broken? Well, then you'd be in the exact same situation as USS Boxer. After returning from an overseas deployment in 2019, USS Boxer went into overhaul maintenance. But a group in charge of sourcing repair parts decided to cut a few corners to save on costs and time. 3 years later, in 2022, the ship failed sea trials, and it was back to the drawing board for repairs. Finally, 2 years later, in 2024, it deployed with the 15th Marine Expeditionary Unit for the first time in 5 years, but only lasted 10 days before having to go back after its rudders failed. Currently, the Navy is putting out contracts for more repairs on the ship that could last all the way until October 2026, 7 years after its last voyage. So is the United States, with its massive fleet of carriers, actually experiencing a shortage? Or are there just too many missions that need sailing? The answer is a little bit of both. Simply building more carriers would be unlikely to solve any issues, because at current levels, the Navy has neither the sailors nor the maintainers to keep more ships afloat. It's not that the Navy has too few carriers, they just don't have enough resources to churn out repairs quickly enough. While the Navy cannot control where and when a mission might pop up, they're exploring different ways to react to them. One is the use of allies to cover down on missions. Since 2022, the American Navy has been training on how to have better interoperability with its foreign friends, allowing for other countries to do a bit more of the heavy lifting in policing the world's oceans. The United States allies have begun offering up their own carriers to help cover down on some of the patrol gaps. This isn't a perfect solution, as ships like the Italian Cavour, the Japanese Izumo, and the French De Gaulle are smaller carriers. Most are only large enough to carry helicopters or VTOL aircraft, and only the French carrier Charles de Gaulle is nuclear-powered and has catapults. Ultimately, though, having these carriers is better than nothing, but simply asking others for help is boring and won't convince Congress to approve more funding for fancier gear. Because aircraft carriers are the United States' most imposing way of enforcing international diplomacy, it's unlikely that we'll see the numbers of carrier deployments go down anytime soon, unless a lot of countries all decide to relax really fast. Due to the demand rising so quickly, the Navy is speeding up the construction of new carriers to join the fleet. As of 2024, USS John F. Kennedy is 90% complete and will be the second four-class carrier in service. USS Enterprise, not that one, is about 35% complete, and its sister ship, USS Doris Miller, is at 13%. The current US Navy plan calls for 141 replacement of Nimitz-class carriers with Ford-class flat tops over the next 40 years. The number of aircraft carriers is expected to peak at 12 in the late 2020s as these new ships are put into service and the old ones still have a few years left until retirement. So we'll be able to see if it's actually a numbers issue. For now though, the United States only has its 11 to work with, so they're going to have to make them count.